graphic audio. A movie in your mind. Graphic Audio LLC presents Living with the Dead, A Zombie Bromance by Mike Richardson. Narrated by Michael John Casey and performed by a full cast. Living with the Dead, A Zombie Bromance. The city still had residents. Despite the death, the hundreds upon thousands of dead, hordes of dead, or rather, undead. It had been some time, but the zombies had taken over all but tiny pockets of survivors across the city, across the world. Those survivors had to scrounge for food, shelter, weapons, for every bit of sustenance as they held on to their lives, to their humanity. Then, there, among the slow-moving undead, a figure sprints across the street and stops by a car hiding behind it, the bald center of his head giving way to a cascade of gray-white, unkempt hair, matched by the ratty beard that flowed out from his face. The old man darted to the sidewalk and ran past a long-since-abandoned newspaper dispenser, with the last day before the fall still in display with a large headline in big block letters that read, "Virus dooms mankind." He took cover again at a bodega entrance next to a rusted car sticking out of the front window of the long-abandoned establishment.
Damn it!
The old man looked about the street, filled with the shuffling undead.
Just gotta reach the other side without being seen.
Slowly, a swamp opens up as two slow-moving groups of undead pass each other, providing a stretch of street with both groups of zombies their backs to the patch of asphalt, dotted by tufts of grass that had long since grown through the cracks in the street. The old man gripped a fork in his right hand to steel his resolve, and then bolted. He scurried across the street like a beleaguered Moses, crossing a zombified Red Sea. The man made it to the other side of the street and quickly huddled in the darkness of an overhang at an open door to a dilapidated old hotel front, and then spun around to see if any of the zombies in the street had taken notice of his flight.
Made it.
The man felt something brush against the back of his left shoulder.
Huh?
The man turned to see a towering zombie with green, heavily rotting skin on his face. This zombie was missing its right eye, and a cloudy red left eye settled on the old man, its lipless mouth agape with purplish gums and brown teeth bared.
Brains.
The zombie leaned down toward the old man, his maw opening wider. The old man jolted and instinctively brought up the fork and stabbed it into the zombie's forehead. The old man then darted out into the street and stopped. All the zombies he just successfully avoided had now all turned back upon hearing his scream and run into the middle of the street. He was completely surrounded. The zombies, led by the one with the fork in his head, advanced on the old man. There was nowhere to run, and the mass of undead swarmed and overtook the helpless elderly man. They clawed and tore at the old man's threadbare clothes and started ripping him apart, devouring his flesh before the man was even dead.
Meat.
Brains.
Meat brains.
As the gang of undead continued to consume the old man, two other zombies walked past with no regard for the feasting taking place. They crossed the street and headed down an alley.
Meat flesh.
The two zombies shuffled across to another street and up the stairs of a brownstone with barbed wire and boarded up windows on the first floor. The shorter, with a red face, pulled out a set of keys and unlocked the door of the brownstone as the larger turned his back to face some of the random undead scattered about the street.
Brains!
The shorter spun his head around and looked at the taller one.
Hey!
The shorter reached out and grabbed the right shoulder of the taller one and yanked him inside the building and immediately slammed the door. A smattering of zombies stared at the door for a moment and then shuffled on groaning as if nothing had occurred. Once inside the brownstone building, the shorter of the two raised his arms halfway, his palms out.
What the hell were you doing out there?
He then lifted his mask to reveal a square-jawed, brown-haired man sporting a well-trimmed Van Dyke.
You want to give this place away and get us killed?
He lowered the mask to his side and started unbuttoning his jacket to reveal the pants were attached like a jumpsuit, and beneath it, he wore a completely clean set of untattered clothes, of jeans and a black-ringed, dark-blue short-sleeved t-shirt.
And what was all that more brains stuff about?
The shorter man turned away to put his zombie costume on a hook, next to a series of pegs holding random bats, clubs, and machetes, blood staining them all, and bits of dried gore in a crusted pile on the floor beneath the pegs. The larger figure slumped his shoulders slightly and then lifted his mask to reveal a slightly boyish, befuddled face framed with curly, strawberry blonde hair.
I was working on my method.
The shorter man placed the mask around a hanger and shot an annoyed look at the bigger yet simply boyish figure, who also started to take off his outer shell of zombie clothes, revealing a light blue hoodie and jeans.
I used to study acting, you know.
The brown-haired man hung up his zombie costume on another set of pegs further from the door.
We've got a good thing going. Remember our pledge?
The larger man hung up his zombie cover and turned around with an eager nod.
Yeah. Make lemonade out of a lemon.
Right. And who's the straw that stirs the drink?
You are.
Look, we have a routine that we practiced over and over. One simple slip up and we're zombie meat.
I'm sorry, straw. I just got carried away.
The lumbering bigger man took a few steps away toward a common room off the main floor of the brownstone.
But I had talent. I could have been good.
Straw stepped over to his large companion.
Look, Whip, we just need to be careful. Friends?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.